Well, as you probably already know, folks, we only use the very best music on this program, the hour of the time. That was U2, and I still haven't found what I'm looking for. You know, many of you write and ask why I let the music go on through the whole selection instead of fading it out and then bringing in the program. I do that, folks, out of sincere admiration and respect for the talent and the performance of the writer of the music, the lyrics, and of course those who perform. I love music, if you haven't guessed that already. Tonight is part two of our interview with William Morgan, and many of you are wondering if that's his real name. No, it is not. We protect CADGI members. We never tell anyone how many CADGI members we have, where they're at, what their names are, anything. None of that information is given out, not even to other CADGI members. Now, we use the code name or the pseudonym of William Morgan simply because the name William Morgan is significant in the past of the secret society called Freemasonry. William Morgan was murdered by Freemasons after having revealed, printed in a book, some of the secrets of the Lodge, and this was done back in the 1800s. Of course, the Fraternity of Freemasons denies that they murdered William Morgan. However, their version differs significantly from the official version and from the proof and the evidence that we have spent many, many hundreds of man hours digging up. And one of these nights, we're going to do a program just entirely on the murder of William Morgan. Will, welcome back to the Hour of the Time.
Thank you, Bill. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm really proud and happy to be here and doing what I'm doing.
You know, I don't think a lot of people realize that you're risking your life by doing this. The oaths that you have taken, albeit because they were fraudulent, you thought that you were making an oath to the God of the Bible, and in fact, you were making an oath to Lucifer, which nullifies those oaths, but they still... The Brotherhood, the Order, the Illuminati, the Freemasons could still carry out the threat of those oaths, which is murder. Is that not correct?
Absolutely correct. No matter what I may personally feel about or what common law or the actual law may view about those oaths as taken, the Masons that are involved consider them to be absolutely applicable to any transgression. And they have been enforced, and the bloody punishments that are part of the oaths have happened to Masons before, and they will happen again, I'm sure.
Now, you are what degree? Let's get that out for the people in case we have some new listeners tonight. What degree are you?
I am a 32nd degree Freemason of the Scottish Rite of the Southern Jurisdiction of the United States.
And what is the official title of that degree?
The official title is the Sublime Prince of the Royal Secret, and that is not only the title of the degree, it is also the title of the ritual that the degree is conferred to. And just to show you how important that is, after going through the ritual and getting the degree conferred upon me, I could neither remember anything sublime or even remember what the secret was that they told me.
Why is it that you couldn't remember the secrets of the degree?
Well, that's a bit of a long story, and I won't go entirely into it, but it started off the day I was conferred, began at 6 o'clock in the morning, and they just rushed through it. There was no memory work to do, as in the Blue Lodge, where a person has to memorize the ritual and then give it back. You just sit there and receive in an audience-like capacity. When it came to swearing the oath, you merely held up your hand and said, "I do." You also did take that oath on kneeling on one knee, as you did in the Blue Lodge.
Now, we talked yesterday after we recorded the last program that aired, I believe Friday, on WRNO, and this will air on Monday on WRNO. It will air at a different date on WWCR. So if you're listening on WWCR, don't let these dates confuse you. But we talked, and I asked you specifically, if there was a part of Freemasonry where you raised your arm to the square, and what was your reply?
Yes, there is a part where you raise your arm to the square. The first time I remember doing that action was in the second degree when it was conferred upon me. You raise your right hand as if you're swearing in. Actually, it is exactly the same position as if you're swearing in a court of law. Your left hand is placed flatly upon the Holy Bible or whatever holy text that, depending on the lodge you're in, and your right hand is held at a right angle with the arm extended, and an actual square, like an engineer's square, is held around the elbow of the arm. It's, you're swearing in a square within a square, so to speak, as the ritual says.
Now, if a Freemason were speaking in front of a group of what Masons call the profane, would it be fair to state that if the speaker stated something about when he raised his arm to the square, that this could be a recognition signal to notify other Freemasons in the audience that he was indeed a Freemason?
Knowing what I know, I could hardly see it as anything else. There's no square involved in any other oath swearing ceremony that I've ever heard of, ever, not in a court of law. Only a square is involved in Masonry. It's one of the it's one of the primary tools that are symbolically referred to in all the ritual of the Blue Lodge.
Now, many of you have heard this this statement made by someone that that you all listen to, and I want you to make that connection for yourselves. If you can't, if you can't make that connection for yourself, then there's no need to telling you any more about it anyway. Let's get into some of the ceremonies. How does this start? It begins in the Blue Lodge with the first degree of entered apprentice, and it goes up, and you've actually traversed 32 degrees of initiation. Are there side roads off of this?
Well, it's a bit difficult. The Blue Lodge is where everything begins, and the Blue Lodge where Mason is initiated at is called the Mother Lodge from that time after, in specific reference to him personally. Now, once you get past the third degree, become a Master Mason in your Blue Lodge, you are able to hold an officer, or hold a chair as an officer inside the lodge. You can spend up to 10 years going through the chairs and becoming an officer. But after that, you can either go to the Scottish Rite or the Yorkish Rite. There's a fork in the road of Masonry, and the Scottish Rite is by far the most popular and undoubtedly the most powerful.
Now, the York Rite is has 7 degrees. Is that true?
True. The highest of which being the Knight Templar degree. For all those people out there who think that the Knights Templar are no way associated with Masons, you're dead wrong, and you haven't done your homework.
In fact, the Knights Templar, when they first began as an organization on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, were not an order commissioned or ordained or approved or even recognized by any church, much less the Catholic Church, but were, in fact, an order of the mysteries. They began with 7 degrees, and the 7th degree was the highest degree. And later, as they added degrees, when the Knights Templar were persecuted and in fact, many of them were put to death. Others were driven into hiding in other countries. In some of the countries, they just changed their names and continued the order. They eventually reached a number of degrees, which was 33. And I took that right out of a very old textbook on the secret societies, which we'll talk about some in a later program, and we'll get into that. But what is the significance that you've been told of the system of degrees? Why do you have to go through this?
It's considered a road. It's considered a road to quote-unquote illumination. I really believe that it's more of a system of control and self-government. Lodges are...